My dear doctor friends, this is Dr. Jatan from Krishnagar. Welcome to the channel Geo Jatan. Geo stands for Gynecology and Obstetrics. Medical science needs continuous update of knowledge and recent advances. We doctors cannot leave our hospital and go for conferences frequently. YouTube has seen tremendous explosion of knowledge in different fields of science and technology, but not in the field of medicine, including obstetrics and gynecology. So, my dear friends, this is my sincere attempt to bridge the gap. Hope you will definitely like it and it will enrich you. So, my dear doctor friends, my name is Dr. Jatan Kumar Rai Choudhury, and today's topic of discussion is diabetes in pregnancy. I am highly indebted to the textbook of Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine, Obstetrics, Normal and Problem Pregnancies, High Risk Pregnancy Management Options, Williams Obstetrics, and ACOG-RCOG Journals. Fetal risks involved in diabetes, especially stillbirth. Now, unexplained fetal demise is 3 to 4 times higher in pre-gestational diabetes, not in gestational diabetes, but pre-gestational diabetes, where diabetes is affecting before pregnancy. Chronic intrauterine hypoxia may be the cause. Not that the fluctuation of the glucose level, but hypoxia or oxygen deficiency is the most important cause of stillbirth. How it is proved? Because there is always extramedullary hematopoiesis frequently observed in stillbirth babies. Hyperinsulinemia and hyperglycemia, that means all the metabolic effects of diabetes, both are linked to fetal hypoxia. And in addition to diabetes, maternal obesity, vascular complication, pregnancy-induced hypertension, poor control of sugar, advanced diabetes, and ketoacidosis. Especially ketoacidosis is very detrimental. They are also responsible for sudden unexplained stillbirth. Even these conditions may cause second trimester. They can cause second trimester stillbirth also. Macrosomia as such is an important cause of stillbirth, and especially it not only affects the antenatal, but it also affects the intranatal problem like shoulder dystocia during delivery, and that may also cause some cases of stillbirth. Apart from sudden unexplained fetal death, congenital malformation is the most important leading cause of perinatal mortality in a case of diabetes, and it primarily affects pre-gestational diabetes, whether it is type 1 or type 2. And the increase in congenital malformation is 2 to 6 fold than the normal population. And it is directly related to the degree of glycemic control. That means more the hemoglobin A1C is more, the more is the congenital malformation. And there is no significant difference in incidence and type between type 1 and type 2. Whether this cardiac varieties are common in type 1 or the CNS varieties are common in type 2. There are no difference whether that diabetes is type 1 or type 2. Any pre-gestational diabetes will give similar type of congenital malformations. And that hyperglycemia must exist in the first trimester before 7th week. As we know that these anomalies are blastogenic. So, they should affect before 7th week of pregnancy. CNS malformations are quite common. These three are very common: anencephaly, open spina bifida, holoprosencephaly, and they are increased roughly 10-fold. Cardiac malformations are also very common, and these two are typically very common: VSD, ventricular septal defect, and transposition of the great vessels, and they are increased 5-fold. Most characteristic diabetic embryopathies: sacral agenesis or caudal dysplasia, which is though rare but still in diabetes it is increased 200 to 400 times than normal population. Maternal hyperglycemia is the primary teratogenic factor, but still hyperketonemia, somatomedin inhibition, free oxygen radicals and arachidonic acid deficiency, these are also involved in the process of teratogenesis. The rate of abnormality, congenital abnormality in gestational diabetes mother may be twice the normal, though GDM affects in the later part of the pregnancy, but still the rate of congenital abnormality is twice. Why? Because it reflects some undiagnosed type 2 diabetes, because we have missed some cases of diabetes in the first trimester and stamped them as gestational diabetes mellitus later on. One important fetal risk is fetal macrosomia. Now, macrosomia is defined as birth weight, which is more than 4 kg or 4.5 kg. Some say 4.5 kg. But any large for gestational age babies, whether at birth or during the measurement in ultrasonography in antenatal period, more than 90th percentile or 2 standard deviation above mean will be considered LGA, considering the gestational age of that fetus or the baby, population studied, and sometimes sex of the fetus. Now, macrosomia affects nearly 50% of the GDM cases and 40% of the pre-GDM mothers, even they are treated for glycemia. This phenomenon is explained by Pedersen hypothesis, which says that maternal hyperglycemia leads to increased transplacental facilitated diffusion and fetal hyperglycemia. And this fetal hyperglycemia causes pancreatic, fetal pancreatic stimulation, increased beta cell mass, and resulting in hyperinsulinemia. And this hyperinsulinemia causes or augments fetal growth in muscle, bone, and fat. Now, glucose becomes a full-fledged fetal insulin secretagogue around 26 weeks time. That means development of the beta cell mass, their response to glucose, synthesis of insulin, everything becomes prominent by 26 weeks. That is, that explains why acceleration of fetal growth occurs around this time. However, maternal hyperglycemia can program the fetal pancreas to respond much earlier. Studies show that fetus of mother with diabetes remain hyperinsulinemic despite good control of blood sugar, explaining that the pancreatic reprogramming has occurred in the early gestation. That means whenever the initial part of the fetal development is complicated by diabetes, process of hyperinsulinemia develops by fetal pancreatic beta cell programming, even if you control diabetes later on. And the pattern of growth is not global, unlike other mother with normal glucose tolerance test. In a normal macrosomic mother, other than diabetic, there is a global enlargement of the fetus. But in diabetes, fat mass is increased more than the fat-free mass. And not only that, additionally, growth is disproportionate with shoulder to head and chest to head ratio becomes larger, which we often encounter during delivery of a diabetic baby. And this ultimately results in shoulder dystocia. Now, all fetus will not be macrosomic. Any mother who is suffering from some vascular complication, or if the fetus is suffering from some congenital malformation, there may be cases of IUGR instead of macrosomia. We all know that diabetic babies suffer from respiratory distress syndrome. In a normal fetal development, cortisol acts on pulmonary fibroblast to synthesize fibroblast pneumocyte factor. And this factor in turn acts on type 2 pneumonocyte for phospholipid synthesis. Insulin blocks cortisol at the level of fibroblast. Apart from this cortisol block by insulin, hyperglycemia and hyperinsulinemia can also interfere with the substrate availability and biosynthesis process of surfactant. Now, three possible causes of respiratory distress. First, sometimes premature birth and respiratory distress syndrome. Caesarean section birth, which are often associated with transient tachypnea due to delayed resorption of lung fluid and surfactant deficiency. And last but the most important cause is delayed appearance of phosphatidylglycerol. So both this fibroblast pneumocyte factor as well as interference with synthesis of surfactant and also caesarean section, sometimes premature birth, all are important factors leading to respiratory distress syndrome. Another important fetal risk is neonatal hypoglycemia when the blood glucose level falls below 35 to 40 milligram per deciliter. Now, it results from rapid drop in plasma glucose after the cord is clamped. And this hypoglycemia is a byproduct of the fetal hyperinsulinemia. And it results from poor glycemic control, especially in the late gestation and delivery. Now, in a normal fetus, whenever the cord is clamped and the glucose starts falling, the metabolic pathway of glucose production occurs like glycogenolysis, neoglucogenesis, lipolysis, everything becomes active. But hyperinsulinemia inhibits the activation of this metabolic pathway of glucose production. So ultimately the fetus suffers from hypoglycemia. And typically this hypoglycemia lasts several days, needs frequent monitoring and early active feeding. Some other fetal risks are neonatal hypocalcemia when the serum level is less than 7 to 8 milligram per deciliter. Now in diabetes, the fetus often suffers from prematurity birth asphyxia. They are also important causes of hypocalcemia. And in diabetes, there may be failure to increase parathormone synthesis after birth, which is also responsible for hypocalcemia. Other than hypocalcemia, there is decreased magnesium level is also documented. Polycythemia is documented because of hypoxia. And hyperbilirubinemia is also noticed because of prematurity and polycythemia. And one other important risk is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which affects the interventricular septum and right ventricle because of fat and glycogen deposition by hyperinsulinemia. Usually it is asymptomatic, sometimes may produce cardiorespiratory problem. Diabetes and pregnancy can interact significantly and jeopardize the maternal health. However, excluding retinopathy, long-term course of diabetes is not affected during this short period of 9 months of pregnancy. Preeclampsia is quite common. It is developed in cases of diabetes 3 to 4 times with over-diabetes. Diabetic nephropathy is also a special entity, and we all know that diabetes is the leading cause of end-stage renal disease. Detectable nephropathy starts beginning with microalbuminuria 30 to 300 milligram per 24 hours. However, macroalbuminuria, that is more than 300 milligram per 24 hours, usually develops before end-stage renal disease. Hypertension invariably develops during this period. It is an usual accompaniment, hypertension. However, both ACE inhibitors and ARBs, which are renoprotective, they are contraindicated in pregnancy because they may cause fetal proximal tubal dysgenesis and oligohydramnios. So, the more maternal proteinuria, more the cases of preeclampsia, preterm delivery, and intrauterine growth restriction. Diabetic retinopathy is the most important cause of visual impairment. Now, starting with non-proliferative retinopathy, that means small microaneurysm followed by blot hemorrhage. It advances to proliferative retinopathy in the form of cotton wool exuded. Ischemia and neovascularization results in vitreous hemorrhage with scarring, which ultimately leads to retinal detachment. Laser photocoagulation before hemorrhage may reduce the rate of visual loss. Pregnant women with pre-existing diabetes should routinely be offered retinal assessment after the first antenatal visit. Laser photocoagulation and good glycemic control will minimize the risk. However, severe disc neovascularization, which is unresponsive to laser, may deteriorate during pregnancy. So also sometimes rigorous glycemic control may worsen diabetic retinopathy pregnancy. Diabetic ketoacidosis, though not so common, but in approximately 1% of cases, it may develop and it results from insulin deficiency combined with excess counter-regulatory hormone like glucagon, which happens in type 1 diabetes mostly, and which ultimately leads to gluconeogenesis and ketone body formation. Serum beta-hydroxybutyrate is a very good marker and it is an accurate reflection of ketone body. More common in type 1, however, it may be found in type 2 also. And it develops in whenever a diabetic mother develops hyperemesis, infection, or gets treatment with beta mimetic drug for tocolysis or receives corticosteroid for lung maturation, be careful of this condition of diabetic ketoacidosis. And again, any diabetic mother, if the suddenly one blood sugar level comes up, that means becomes suddenly hyperglycemic or feels unwell, test for ketone bodies. You shall have to be very suspicious about it. Apart from routine management, vigorous rehydration with crystalloid is an important therapy. Pre-pregnancy counseling is very important in diabetes. So all women with pre-gestational diabetes, that means when we know diabetes is present before pregnancy, in their reproductive age group, they should receive at least one pre-pregnancy counseling. What is the aim? The aims are to provide education about optimal time of pregnancy, risk of congenital abnormality with unplanned pregnancy and poor glycemic control, detecting diabetes related complications like retinopathy and nephropathy, evaluating all sorts of glucose lowering drugs, switching to safer antihypertensive drug, providing pre-pregnancy dietary advice and folate supplementation, ways of controlling the strict glucose level during the pregnancy, and the importance of a perinatal diabetic team. Screening for overt diabetes and gestational diabetes mellitus. Now the frequency of diabetes complicating pregnancy is around 6% to 7%, and 90% of which is gestational diabetes mellitus. The incidence of diabetes is rapidly increasing in Asia, Africa and Native America. One other important observation for gestational diabetes mellitus is that most cases of gestational diabetes mellitus have normal fasting glucose. So, some form of glucose challenge must be done to reveal those cases. Traditionally, all patients were not subjected for glucose estimation. Obstetricians usually relied on history and clinical risk factors like family history of diabetes, previous birth, when there is a stillbirth, malformed birth, macrosomic birth, or when the mother is obese, hypertensive or elderly, and any routine antenatal checkup has revealed glycosuria. These are the cases where routinely blood sugar estimation were done. As a part of screening, nowadays most of the pregnant women are offered two blood sugar estimations, one at the first antenatal checkup and the other at 24 to 28 weeks. ACOG suggests that all pregnant women be screened for gestational diabetes mellitus at 24 to 28 weeks because GDM is most common variety of diabetes. A simple approach to early screening, that means when the first screening for diabetes is made, is to obtain an hemoglobin A1C level. Whenever that value is more than or equal to 6.5%, an overt diabetes diagnosis is made, and any value between 5.7% to 6.4%, suggesting impaired glucose tolerance, a diagnostic glucose tolerance test should be offered. And for normal results, that means less than 5.7%, a second screening for gestational diabetes mellitus at 24 to 28 weeks should be done. And there are different strategies regarding the measurement of glucose level, that may be 50 gram 1 hour, 75 gram 2 hour or 100 gram 3 hour OGTT. And data are insufficient regarding superiority of one over the other. Thank you for your patient watching. If you like the video, please subscribe. Namaste.